Hello. So this is a film about Japanese aggression towards China between 1895 and 1945. Japan play a hugely important part in the history of China in the first half of the 20th century, actually throughout the 20th century, and they're still a very significant country to China today. Japanese and Chinese relations were not good for a large part of the 20th century. In fact, are still not really that good. And arguably, the beginning of that was with a war between Japan and China in 1894. There was a war between 1894 and 1895, and Japan, the small island nation off the coast of China, defeated the mighty Chinese Empire. Now, that itself was a huge shock to the Chinese and a huge humiliation to the Chinese. The Chinese had thought that they were a superior nation. They had thought that they were a superior civilization, that they were the center of the earth. And here they were being beaten by their small Asian island neighbor, the Japanese. And the reason that happened was essentially that the Japanese had industrialized and militarized long in the second half of the 19th century, and the Chinese simply hadn't. The Japanese had modernized, and the Chinese hadn't. The Chinese, under the leadership of the Qing dynasty, and in the latter years of the Qing dynasty, Cixi and Guangxu, followed by Puyi, just failed to modernize and failed to catch up with the modernizing, industrializing countries of Europe and the West, which is why countries like France and Britain and Germany were able to establish treaty ports in China. And they didn't catch up, they didn't keep up with Japan either. And Japan had emulated the industrialization of those Western European countries. So in the war of 1894, 1895, Japan defeated China pretty easily. And as a consequence of that defeat, Japan took control of Korea and Taiwan from China. Now, Korea had been what was known as a tributary state to China. I had a kind of subordinate relationship to the Chinese. It was an independent kingdom. It did nominally have its own independence, but it was a subordinate independence to China. But in 1895, Japan took it off them, took control of Korea. And they also took control of Taiwan from China. So it was a humiliating blow to the Chinese. And it was the first, really, in 50 years of aggression towards the Chinese. After that, the next big event featuring Japanese aggression towards the Chinese was in the Boxer Rebellion of 1900. The Japanese provided soldiers that were part of the international army that put down and suppressed the Boxer Rebellion that had been encouraged by Empress Dowager Cixi. And the Japanese were part of the consortium of foreigners that imposed huge reparations on China as a result of the Boxer Rebellion. A few years after that, the Japanese then went to war with Russia, the mighty Russian Empire, which, like the Chinese Empire, was also weak and had serious internal problems. And again, the small island nation of Japan defeated a mighty empire. They defeated the Russians and they took territory from Russia around the Manchuria region, around the Russian-Chinese border, around Manchuria. And they took control of some Chinese territory in Manchuria as a result of victory in that war. That was followed by 10 years later, when China was in a very unstable position after the failure of the revolution in 1912, and after Yuan Shikai had established himself as the leader of China after he'd betrayed the GMD. Yuan Shikai was forced to accept a notorious set of demands that the Japanese made of his government. Those demands were known as the 21 demands. Japan demanded that they had influence over Chinese economic decision making and over Chinese certain branches of Chinese government. And Yuan, in a weak position without any international allies, without strong control of the whole country, excuse me, felt that he had to accept Japan's 21 demands. Then again, just after the First World War, Japan and China had fought on the side of the Allies in the First World War, i.e. they'd fought on the side of Britain and France and America and Russia, and until Russia had withdrawn from the war. And at the famous Treaty of Versailles in Paris after the First World War to decide what should be done about Europe, the Allies decided that the Japanese could take control of land in China that previously had been governed by the Germans, because the Germans, like the French and British and Japanese and Russians, they'd taken concession areas and treaty ports in China in the second half of the 19th century. And China felt that as they were on the side of the Allies, that they would get that land back from the Germans at the end of the First World War. And in fact, they'd been promised that by the Allies. But Japan had already secretly agreed with the Allies that they would take control of that land after the First World War. China felt hugely betrayed by that, but also powerless really to do anything much about it, because the Americans and the British and the French had decided that that was what was going to happen. The Americans and British and French had done it because of the greater amount of help that the Japanese had given them in the First World War than the Chinese had. And so China felt powerless, really, to do anything about that agreement made at the Treaty of Versailles. It caused a huge amount of anger and disgust in China, and it caused the famous May 4th movement, the movement of protests and riots and anger that spread across China after the Treaty of Versailles. And it was that movement that played a key part in the birth of the Chinese Communist Party and in the resurgence of the GMD as well. However, despite having said all of that, the Americans especially and the British and French were a bit wary of Japanese intentions towards China in the 1920s. And there was an international conference held in Washington in 1922. And one of the things that came out of that international conference was that no one country should be able to completely dominate China, that there should be what was known as an open door policy towards China. That is, that all countries should be able to trade with China, to establish businesses there, to operate freely in concession areas and treaty ports, and that Japan shouldn't become too powerful with regards to China. So Japan wasn't allowed to get away with everything that it wanted to in China, although it still was very influential and threatening towards the Chinese. Allegedly, in 1927, the Japanese Prime Minister, a man called Mr. Tanaka, wrote a document in which he outlined his plans towards China. And his plans were for Japan, first of all, to take land in Manchuria, because Manchuria had a huge amount of space and resources, and there was space there for the Japanese population to live. It was relatively industrialized, and it was a relatively wealthy part of China, and Japan felt that there were resources and space that the Japanese people needed there in Manchuria that they didn't have on their own small, fairly mountainous island. So Mr. Tanaka allegedly had this plan, first of all, to invade Manchuria, and then from Manchuria, using it as a base, to fan out through the rest of China, to dominate China, and then allegedly to go on from China and go on to dominate the rest of Asia, and perhaps even into even further afield. Now, the reason I say this is alleged, because this document, this document that Mr. Tanaka wrote, was found during the Second World War, and the Allies, that is the British and the American, the Chinese, used it as proof of Japanese imperial expansionist plans. But it was, there's a lot of argument about it and a lot of debate, and some scholars, in fact quite a few scholars, think it was a fake, and that it was produced by either the Chinese or the Americans or the British as a to justify their actions in China in the 1940s and to justify the actions that they were taking against the Japanese. Now, whether it was fake or not is kind of irrelevant, really, because the fact is that in the 1930s and into the 1940s, the Japanese did follow a very imperialist, expansionist foreign policy. For example, in 1931, they did invade Manchuria. And they did take control of Manchuria and take it off the Chinese. And they did establish the last emperor of China, Puyi, as their kind of puppet ruler of Manchuria. And they established Manchuria as a new state, calling it Manchukuo. They also engaged in a short war with China in Shanghai in 1932. And as a result of that war, forced the Chinese to demilitarize Shanghai. In 1935, they forced the Chinese to give up control of Hebei province and Inner Mongolia province in the north of China. And effectively, the Japanese were in control of a large chunk of northern China in by 1936. And then in 1937, there was a clash between Japanese soldiers and Chinese soldiers on a bridge called the Marco Polo Bridge just outside of Beijing. And as a result of that clash, the Japanese demanded that they should be able to take control of Beijing, the capital, well, the ex-capital city. At this point, the leader of China, Chiang Kai-shek, the leader of the GMD, said, enough is enough. Up until that point, he'd been forced really to accept that he just didn't have the power to deal with the Japanese. He didn't have a strong enough army, and he didn't have any international allies. And perhaps he could have taken more action against the Japanese than he did, because he was too busy kind of chasing the CCP, who he regarded as the greater threat. But he didn't really have, probably, even if he hadn't been attacking the CCP, and even if he had been sort of focusing his energies on dealing with the Japanese and their gradual incursion into China and their threatening aggressive behaviour, he still wasn't really in a strong enough position to be able to deal with them. He didn't even control all the territory of his own country, never mind be able to deal with the threat of a much stronger threat from the Japanese. But in 1937, Chiang Kai-shek said, enough is enough. The reason he said that is because he was forced to, really, by the by his allies in the GMD and by the young marshal, the warlord of Manchuria. And I think I talked about his role in an earlier film. And he was forced to, Chiang Kai-shek was forced to reform the United Front that had existed between 1923 and 1927. He was forced to bring it back, a united front between his party, the GMD, and the CCP, this time to fight the Japanese. And that was when he said, that's it, enough is enough. Apparently, he famously said, the limits of endurance have been reached. And he said, now it's war. And he declared war between China and Japan. And I think I'll make a separate film about the war between China and Japan.